What we need are basic modular operations: addition, subtraction, multiplication, exponentiation, and multiplicative inverse. And this all in a finite field with you hit the modulo and you start back from zero, right? So all these operations need to work on arbitrary size large positive integer. And by the way, this is one thing where Smalltalk just shines thanks to our large positive integer implementations, because you don't need to worry about all the other stuff like other languages. You don't need to do set up a structure, allocate memory, whatever. So these operations are found in an integer and in subclasses, and they are extensions in the security-based parser. So if you want to explore that stuff, that's where you find them. Here is an example of very silly example of a 128-bit modular exponentiation, where you basically take one very large number raised to another very large number with a certain modulo. Now, if you wanted to do this by actually exponentiating first and then doing the modulo operation, you would run out of memory very quickly. So the algorithms are somewhat, they are optimized for not taking too much memory and too much CPU power. I won't go into details of double n add and square and multiply algorithms. It's not a focus for this talk. The next category is hashing and message digest. We have both Smalltalk native implementations, which are somewhat historical, and external libraries. Let me talk about the Smalltalk native. They have been around for a while. We have MD5 and SHA, which is also known as SHA-1, and SHA-256. So the numbers indicating the 256 indicates that it's a 256 bit, but SHA-1 is, I believe, 160 bit. I don't remember lots of these things from top of my head. There is a lot of literature on the subject. So these classes are in the SHA and MD5 parsers. That's where you find them. Makes sense. The external libraries is something that we have added fairly recently. So we basically have two. We have Crypto, which is part of the OpenSSL distribution. And if all you need is Windows native library, there is a decrypt.dll. They offer roughly equivalent functionality, but of course completely different APIs. The advantage of using the external libraries is that they already did most of the stuff for you, so you just need to figure out the interfaces. And that allows us to use the hybrid hashing, for example, the 384-bit and 512-bit secure hash algorithms. And I would like to point out that I will come back to this fact a little later, that the 256 and 384 and 512, they are what they call the SHA-2 family of algorithms. So if somebody asks, does Cincom Smalltalk offer SHA-2? Yes, we do, provided you use the external libraries. The classes that implement the wrappers are LiveCryptoHash and DecryptHash, and you find them, maybe a little bit surprisingly, in the parser called Extremes-Crypto. The reason is that in some of the underlying code, we need efficient streaming operations, and the Extremes library is really good for that. So we basically built as an additional library to Extremes. If you have used our security product before, you may know the class called hash in the security namespace. That class is outdated and we may deprecate it in the near future. So you should be using extremes.hash, which is part of the extremes-crypto package or parcel. That's the correct class to use. And here's one of the examples of I told you about. So you basically create an instance of the algorithm with SHA1 as the parameter, and you give it a message. You it updates the it does some of the hashing algorithm work, and when you are done, you say hash finish and release the instance, so you can do some garbage collection and so on. And then the digest contains a byte array, which is the digest of your message. Okay, so that's at the very basic level. Now we also have a streaming interface to that. We have two classes called digest write stream and digest read stream, and they are both accessed through hashing along method. They kind of have a parallel API. So the first example here is you create a writing stream on byte array with the SHA-1 as the name of the algorithm that you will be using, and then you can write messages to it. So it's like for larger amount of data, you can just write bytes until you are done, and then you close the stream and send in a message digest, and that's you get the same value as in the previous slide. Now, if you are reading, it's obviously just the inverse operation. So you have some messages coming in. I simplify the example. Excuse me. So you have received some bytes, maybe over the wire, so you create a read stream and say this should be SHA-1, and you just consume the rest of the stream and send in the message digest, and you get the same value. Next, extremely important category is secure randomness. It is essential for generating of private keys and key exchange parameters, some of them. And it is, compared to your regular pseudo-random generator, it's much more complicated, because in security, you need as much unpredictability in the random bits as possible, and the pseudo-random generators don't offer that. So what we do is we use some of the underlying operating system technology on Linux, for example, or OS X, any of the Unix operating systems. They include file descriptor /dev/urandom, which is an unlimited non-blocking source of random bits derived from the operating system and from the machine itself. How they do it, I don't know, it's black magic, but that's... Again, I'm pressing buttons. Okay, this will work. On Windows, there is an API that is roughly equivalent called CryptGenRandom, and we encapsulate these OS-specific sources in a class called DSSRandom, which does all the seeding from these random bit sources. And it's very simple to use. You say DSSRandom, new next, and it gives you... it's configurable. I believe the default is 20 bytes of random bits. And this class is found in parsing cipher space. And we will move on to encryption. Of course, we are kind of getting, like, building up the layers and the complexity, right? So, as many of you probably know, we have two basic types of encryption: symmetric, which uses the same key for encryption and decryption. It is very efficient, doesn't consume much memory, it's fast. The biggest problem with symmetric encryption is the problem of sharing the keys securely. So if you have Alice who has a shared key with Bob, how do they exchange the keys without some man in the middle attack? And you know, so usually these are secondary protocols or secondary algorithms that get used once some more complex algorithm calculates a shared key, and I'm going to talk about it a little later. So examples are AES, which is the Advanced Encryption Standard. It is, I think it is arguably the most advanced encryption algorithm. It was sponsored by NSA in a public competition, I think about a decade ago. Then you have the older ones, the ES, ARC4. You'd have to read a little bit about the algorithms if you want to use them in kind of smaller project or whatever. And the parcels are corresponding to classes. So the second class of encryption algorithms are the public key or public slash private key algorithms. The most popular is RSA. There is DSA, which is the digital signature algorithm, developed on key exchange. And I'm getting to some of the new stuff that we did for the upcoming visual release 8.1, and these are ECDSA and ECDH. Those two are in combined in a parcel named ECC. The rest of them again have classes and parcel names corresponding with each other. So what is ECC? ECC stands for Elliptic Curve Cryptography. It's a fascinating stuff. When I started reading on it, I was like, this is so cool. I am kind of let's leave it at that. ECC offers more security per bit of key size than, for example, RSA. So they become faster and more efficient, and that's one reason why they are being quite widely adopted. This is still a little bit work in progress for us. We have the native Smalltalk implementation of the 256-bit key size, but larger keys require SHA-384 and SHA-512, which, if you recall, I mentioned, require the external libraries, so they are not yet Smalltalk native, and I don't know if we'll even do that, because once you have the external library support, the chances that you absolutely have to have the Smalltalk native are fairly slim. The external library for now only includes live crypto, and the reason for that is that that's part of OpenSSL, and you can have OpenSSL installed pretty much anywhere. So by supporting live crypto first, we basically covered the most bases. In the VisualWorks 8.2, we would like to include the routers for the Windows native API, the decrypt library. So here is an example of ECDSA, which is Elliptic Curve Digital Signature Algorithm. It's very simple. Basically, we have an abstract class called private key, and it has some API. You just give one of the APIs is algorithm column size code, and you just give it the algorithm identifier in this case and the size of the key, and it figures out under the covers what library do you need to use, if you have the right implementation and everything, and gives you a private key. So then you take a message, here is a signed message of byte array. You need to be careful, when, especially if you start encoding like UTF-8 strings, so you would want to know which encoding to use to convert it to byte array. But for the simplicity of the examples, I just say lighter rate here. And then you generate the signature by saying Alice sign colon message. Now, Bob will know Alice's public key, so I just store the, you know, the Bob public key, Alice's public key in the Bob variable, and then you just say verify colon signature of colon message. And that's it. Very simple and clean interface. And this is, as I mentioned, in the ECC parser. And the last of the big security component categories is key exchange. And this solves the problem of exchanging securely keys without really sending them across the wire. The most widely used algorithm for that is the Feldman, which allows computation of a shared key, of a shared secret from the private and public keys and some other public parameters that are shared between the two parties. This has been Smalltalk native since VisualWorks 7.1, and in VisualWorks 7.9 we actually introduced the Live Crypto and Decrypt interfaces. And this is typically used, among other things, in SSL and DLS handshakes, where the client and server calculate the shared secret based on some parameters that they exchange during the initial phase of the handshake. And it's equivalent in the elliptic curve space is elliptic curve, if you have non ECDH. It is used a lot. There is a website, I think it's ssllabs.com, and they have, you can put an address of a secure server, and they will list all kinds of things about the server, and among other things, the cipher speeds that the server supports. And this is how we actually found, based on some customer requests, that, you know, elliptic cryptography really is, you know, being implemented widely, and that was the case for us also doing it. So in Cincom VisualWorks 8.1, it is supported in all versions of TLS from version 1 to the current version 1.2. And but as I said, currently on platforms with OpenSSL 1.0 or higher. ECDH native Windows support should be coming in VisualWorks 8.2. We still haven't finalized the plan, but that's basically the idea. Again, an example, you create a private key with some algorithm parameters, ECDHE, 256 bits. You store the public key, in, you know, they correlate, right? So once you know private key, you know how to generate and calculate the public key that you can distribute. Now, when you have a key, it also has some randomly and some predefined parameters, or default parameters, I should say, and they are called elements. So you, in order to create the client-side private key, you need to pass the parameters from the server private key. And this, just to make it clear, of course, does not include the actual randomly generated private key, only the parameters used for it. So that way, the client now can create the corresponding parameters with its own randomly generated private key. From that, it derives the public key. And now you have two sets of private and public. And each private can derive the secret, the shared secret, from the other party's public. So those are the two last lines where basically you say the server private derive the client public, and the client private derive the server public, and the two values are identical. And only the owners, only the parties that know the generation parameters and their own private key can do this. So it solves that shared secret exchange. So finally we are getting to the top layer of the stack, if you will, and that's SSL and DLS. So they use the combination of these, the secure randomness, the hashing, the encryption, the signature algorithms, in a combination to establish a secure connection. SSL has been supported in visual works for a long time, since version 5i. SSL version 2 was basically abandoned in the 90s, replaced by version 3, which is still in use, but now officially broken since last year with the Poodle attack. It was widely publicized, you may remember that. It was, I believe, in October last year. So now the official recommendation is not to use SSL version 3. We still support it, but what we have done in the Visual Works 8.1 is add a resumable exception. So if you insist on using SSL version 3, you just resume that exception in your application. You know, that way we basically let our customers know you should avoid it, but if you want to use it, you just resume it. Good. We would like to deprecate SSL version 3 in Visual Works 3.2 and completely remove it in subsequent release. That will depend probably on one of Arden's mini surveys to see how many of our customers use it. TLS stands for Transport Layer Security, and it is a successor to SSL. It's TLS version 1 would have been SSL version 3.1. And the difference in name is when the different specification bodies change the ownership of the specs. So they just renamed it. But it's basically the message flow and the data structures are the same. So we have supported TLS since Visual Works 7.9, so for about the last 3 years. It is based on extremes, as I mentioned. And we support all the current versions. 1.2 we only started supporting with 8.0. Now these are seamlessly integrated in our Sue HTTP server, so configuring a secure server is fairly easy. Now last year we added, other than DLS 1.2, we also added client authentication, which is basically adding support to more messages during the handshake phase, and that means that when a server receives a request, not only it sends its own certificate chain to the client, but it also asks the client, give me yours. So this could be used in banking and other secure installations where you just don't want anybody to do HTTPS alone, only the authenticated and authorized clients. We added support for renegotiation. I'm running short on time. We have added a growing number of cipher seeds. I already mentioned the ACDHE. And we also have a passcode certificate which handles the reading of external certificate files. The certificate files can be in different formats. It depends on which certification authority you work with. There is no real standard, so you have to figure that one, that part with your CA. And it's on X509 parcel. There is a utility class called Certificate File Reader, which will take the file and read it in the memory. And there is also X509 Registry, which is a class that basically validates the certificate chains. So, you know, when you have a bunch of certificates, you just need to make sure that they follow in the order of certificate authority, intermediate, and so on. With mutual authentication or client authentication, you don't need to worry about trusted certificates if you don't use mutual authentication. And then another class, in this time in TLS parcel, is called your certificate store, and that manages which certificate we already know about, which we own, which are trusted, and so on. Here is an example. I kind of count on people who have interest in this just going to the ESAC website after they post the PDFs and use the examples from that, because it would take a long time. Here is an example of how to start a secure server. So you basically just create one, you say listen on this port for HTTPS connection. Notice I didn't use the standard 443 because I would need root privileges to do that. And then you add a responder and start the server, read the certificates, and there you go. It's a very simple API, very straightforward. I have, do I have a couple more minutes? I started about 4 minutes late. Do I have more minutes, a little bit more time for demo? No? Okay, talk to me after. If you are interested, I can show you one of our tools, how we set up the SUE HTTPS. This is basically it. Questions? Yes?
In discussion with other visitors of the ESA, I got a question about supporting secure LDAP. Do you have something to do?
Okay, so the question is whether we are supporting secure LDAP. Not at the moment, not this coming release, but it's in our plans. So maybe 8.2. Any other questions?
Yes. Have you looked at supporting application directory protocol negotiation for HTTP2?
Yes. Coming. Yes, we have in the upcoming, the next maintenance release, we will have the application layer protocol negotiation extension, but we will not actually support HTTP2 until the next release. All right, thank you.